Thursday evening. We'll have no meetings on Thursday evening, but we will be back on Friday evening. All right? So that is our schedule. And we begin at 7:30 sharp every evening. So make sure you come 7:30 sharp. We are here. The other thing I'd like you to know is that by registering, and later on, I'll ask you to fill out some information for me as well to give me some feedback on the presentation that we will have. So there'll be a response card that you will receive later on from the table host. You will fill those out as well. What later on, don't give it out quite yet, later on, right? What you will do is hand those in addition to your registration, nightly, beginning tomorrow night, we will be drawing from those cards that you've sent in. And as a result of the drawing, you could win a prize. Anybody loves prizes? Yep, a free prize. You don't have to pay for it. It could be a book. It could be a gift card. It could be something special. But make sure you're registered so that you can be entered into the drawing so that you could receive a prize. I am sure that everyone will be registering therefore. In addition, we're going to encourage you to bring a friend. Because as you bring friends with you, you will also be eligible for prizes. So people will be bringing friends nightly. We'll check how many friends you have. At the end of the week, we will see who has brought the most friends. And if you bring the most friends, we have a very special prize for you. It's so special, I'm not going to tell you what it is tonight. But you will want to win that prize when we announce it. So be sure that you bring in some friends. And you can't say I didn't tell you. You can't say I didn't prepare you. But I'm going to encourage you to bring a friend. Now, here are a couple of things. When we close, we begin at 7:30, and we will want to end by 8:45. So that's just an hour and 15 minutes. 7:30 to 8:45. That's why we're not having any long preliminaries. But tomorrow evening, there are a few other things we will add in. And here's what they are. We will be doing a quiz nightly on the presentation, because we're all here to learn. I am here to learn. You're here to learn. We're here to learn together. Is that okay? We're going to learn from God's Word, the Bible. And so be sure that you're paying attention. You should have, I don't see them. Where are they? You should have been given a little binder. You have your binder? Oh, they have the binder. Some people have binders. Does everybody have a binder? All right, some people don't have binders. All right, we need to make sure that you have binders. If you don't have a binder, raise your hand. All right, a couple of hands raised. So see if we can get some binders ready so we can get these folks with a binder, all right? Now, in your binder, you will see a thing called sermon notes. It's an outline of the presentation. Each night, we will give you an outline of the presentation. In addition, there are pens on the table. We ask you to make notes because tomorrow evening there'll be a quiz. Just a brief, short quiz. And if you do well with the quiz, it's an opportunity again for you to enter into receiving a drawing so that you can also get a prize. All right? So be sure you pay attention. So tomorrow evening there'll be a quiz. In addition, you may have questions that you would like to ask. On the back side of your response cards, any question you may have, later on when you're giving your response cards, any question you may have, just write it on the back side of your response card. All right? And we will answer those questions every night. So those are added features that we will have nightly. For those who are guests, For those who are new to this building, if you need to, are you with me? For those who are guests to this building, let me just pause while you, okay, they're getting there, all right? If you do need to, the restrooms are through this door, and you'll see the signs that say restroom. So if you need to, just slip out and use restrooms, and then you can return, all right? Good. Then after the meetings are finished nightly, at 8:45, when we're closed, we will have a light refreshment. So you go again through these doors, and you will see outlined for you a light refreshment. Because I know during the week, some of you will be coming straight from work. Some of you will be perhaps rushing home before you get here, and you may not have a chance to eat. So what a nice person we are. We're going to provide some refreshments for you. We're going to make sure you don't faint before you get home. All right? So every evening, there'll be a little refreshment table set up for you on the outside. So that's what we would like you to do so you can be a part of that experience. So that's what we're looking forward to. We praise the Lord. God is good, isn't he? He's gooder and good, somebody says. All right. So we're looking forward to that. And The name of our series is, the name of our series is In Christ Alone. And tonight, our first presentation is entitled, A Sane Man in a, what kind of a world? A crazy world. A sane man in a crazy, crazy world. Now, let me mention one last thing that I just recalled, and you will want to hear this. We do have, because this is a Bible series, we believe that the Bible and prayer goes together. Are you with me? That we believe that when we talk to God in prayer, powerful things happen. When we talk to God in prayer, miracles happen. When we talk to God in prayer, deliverance takes place. So we believe in prayer. Do you believe in prayer? Yes. Praise the Lord. And so we will have times of prayer. There will be people praying for you. The place will be saturated with prayer. We have individuals who will approach you and ask you if you want prayer. So don't be offended, because we believe in prayer. In addition, before we close these meetings, one of these evenings, and we will announce it ahead of time so you can be prepared for it, we will also be taking time out for a special service of prayer and anointing. We will announce it ahead of time so you're prepared for it, but we will have a night where we'll have special time for prayer and anointing. So you may be struggling with an issue, an illness, some challenge, and you know that the Holy Spirit is ready to change you and to make you over again, and you believe in prayer, so there'll be a time that we'll have for special prayer. So look forward to that. May God bless you as we prepare for that. Just so that you are aware, each table is going to be a little unit. All right? So as much as possible, you nightly that you're here, we're going to encourage you to sit at the same table. Get to know the people at the table with you if you don't know them. Build a little community at your table. All right? So, because each presentation we will be giving you towards the close of my presentation, I'll be giving each table 5 minutes for you to discuss a question with each other. So you'll have a little time just to have a table discussion at your table. And then after the table discussion, I will be polling you. I will give you a question that you will respond to, and you are going to be interactive in this response. Everybody will get a chance to respond, and we will do so in maybe less than 30 seconds. Because here's what you will do if you don't do it. We live in an age of technology, and almost everybody, from the baby to the grandma, has a cell phone. So if you didn't bring your cell phone, tomorrow night bring your cell phone. Because you will be able to dial into a number, and your response will then appear on the screen. And that's how we will be getting feedback together. Is that okay? Amen. Praise the Lord for technology. Won't you say amen? Praise the Lord for technology. And so this is a little different, but God is going to work with us. And I'm sure that when we finish these meetings, you'll be able to say, I am so much more knowledgeable of God's word, and I am so much closer to Jesus Christ. And that's what we want to do, that all of us can come into a kind of a relationship with Christ through the word. As we get ready to begin tonight's presentation, like I said earlier, we do every night, we will have prayer. There'll be a team praying while I'm talking. There'll be a team praying before we talk. I pray before I get here. And then even before we begin our presentation each night, we will take time to pray. And so as we get ready to begin, we are going to pray right now. And so what I want you to do, just bow your heads where you are, as we talk to God for a moment in prayer. God, you're awesome. You're merciful. We thank you for bringing us. We look forward to hearing from you, Lord. Speak to us. Change us. Make us whom you want us to be. As we open your words tonight, may your Holy Spirit sit beside us to open our hearts to the blessings you have for us in your words. In Jesus' name we pray. Let everyone say amen. Amen, amen and amen and amen. Amen. All right. Tonight our presentation, a sane man in a what? In a crazy world. In a crazy world. We are living in some serious times. Are we not? Our world is in a mess. The Bible and all the headlines seem to show that we are living in some very crazy, crazy time. The world is falling apart. The world is going crazy. We can clearly see that things are rapidly moving towards an end. There's terrorism. Am I right? There is ISIS. There's Al-Qaeda. There are wars. There are climate change. There is social and moral and physical devastation all over the world. And all these are but a sign that we are living in the end of time. That's what we are. Some crazy times. A crazy world. There's a story told of a man that was driving down the highway on his way home from work. And while he was driving, he got a call on his cell phone from his wife. She said, "Honey, you know I love you. So hurry up. But be careful, sweetheart, my darling. For a report just came on the radio that there is a crazy man driving the wrong way down the highway." The man responded, "I was just about to call you to tell you, sweetheart, my sugar, that the whole world must have gone crazy. For it's not just one man driving the wrong way. Everybody I pass is driving the wrong way." The world is going crazy and people think it's normal. You know, some of the things that we see happening today, 10 years ago, 15 years ago, 20 years ago, we wouldn't tolerate it. But today it's normal. It's like nothing to us today. Even the crazy one thinks that it's okay. And it's just that maybe I am normal, other people are crazy. The earth is totally wicked and corrupt and sinful. The earth after creation was very good. That's what the Bible says. You know, immediately after creation, the Bible says that the earth, you were to read in Genesis chapter 1, verse 31, the Bible describes that God said at the end of his creation, God said, "Behold, it is very good." Very good. But by time chapter 1 of Genesis closes, and we get into chapter 2 and chapter 3. By the time we get to chapter 5, here's what the Bible says about the world. It says that the wickedness of man was great in the earth. Can you imagine? Between chapter 1 of Genesis, the first book of the Bible. Which book of the Bible is Genesis? The first book. So if you didn't know that before, you know that right now. It's the first book. And between chapter 1 of Genesis and chapter 5 of Genesis, in chapter 1, God says, behold, it is very good. By chapter 5, God says, the wickedness of man is great in the earth. And the Bible says God was sorry. He repented that he had made man. For wickedness had taken over the world in such a short time. Terrorism had taken over. Political dysfunction had taken over. War in the Middle East had taken over. Some of us see the news nightly, whether you watch MSNBC or ABC or CNN or Fox or whatever you watch, we can't escape from the world in which we live. Nightly, young children, refugees escaping from countries like Syria and Yemen who are dying as they crowd into these small boats attempting to flee from the war in their homeland. That's the world in which we live. It's in a mess. Threat of nuclear war. Yeah, if you've been listening, we have a new president here in the United States, and it seems like the war and the tension between the U.S. and North Korea has stepped up. And North Korea is threatening to send missiles to the United States of America, testing their abilities every day. That's the world in which we live. Climate change. Places that once were cold is now hot. And places that once were hot is getting cold. Maybe some of you are thinking, we wouldn't mind a little coolness down here in the summer. There's biological epidemic. Ebola, you remember that a few years ago, right here in Texas. Dangers of asteroid strikes. This world is in a mess. There is moral decay. There is human trafficking taking place. People today, young ladies today, have to be careful because many attractive young ladies are being kidnapped, held hostage, placed into what is called human trafficking. What kind of world do we live in where those things are accepted? In fact, there's this guy called Stephen Hawking. He works as a scientist. He has a particular disease, so he actually sits in a wheelchair. Some of you have heard of him. Very smart guy, very sharp guy, Stephen Hawking. And recently, in fact, the date is there, May 4th, just this month, he says, we actually have 100 years to escape the world. He believes that things are so bad and getting worse that we only have 100 years left on this earth. That's what he thinks. Well, some of us may die by then. Well, maybe all of us may die by then. Except you are maybe, 5 years old. The oldest person in the world is about 117 years old. But he thinks that's the only time we have. But according to the Bible, it's getting worse. That's the text I spoke about earlier. And God saw the what? Wickedness of man. That it was great. It was how? Great in the earth. And that every, how much? Every imagination and thought of his heart was only evil continually. Have mercy, Lord. And it grieved him at his heart that he had made man. In every age, beloved, things have gotten bad. But praise God. The Bible says, in our next text, it says, and the Lord said, I will what? Destroy man whom I have created. God was so upset by the wickedness on earth that God, even in his love for man, felt, I have to clean up this mess. And the only way to clean up the mess is to destroy this earth. He said, he must destroy man whom I have created from the face of the earth, both man and beast. But praise the Lord, somebody found grace in God's eyes. The text says, and Noah did what? Found grace in the eyes of the Lord. In every generation, in every age, God always has some people who finds grace. Oh, amen. People are ready to stand up. When everybody is saying, be wicked and evil, there's somebody who says, I want to stand up for God. When everybody is doing all that would be devilish, there's somebody who said, I want to stand on the word of God. In every age, there's somebody. And in that age, when the world was wicked, it was Noah. And that's the world in which we live, a wicked world. Here's a prayer, which was, and some of you may have seen this, it's been around for a while, by a pastor at the opening of a state senate. He says, and this is the pastor's prayer as the senate was opening. He says, Heavenly Father, we come before you today to ask your forgiveness and to seek your direction and guidance. We know your words say, woe to those who call evil good. But that's exactly what we have done. We have lost our spiritual equilibrium and reversed our values. We have exploited the poor and call it lottery. We have rewarded laziness and called it welfare. We have killed our unborn and call it choice. We have shot abortionists and call it justifiable. We have neglected to discipline our children and called it building self-esteem. We have abused power and called it politics. We have coveted our neighbor's possessions and called it ambition. We have polluted the air with profanity and pornography and called it freedom of expression. We have ridiculed the time-honored values of our forefathers and we call it enlightenment. He says, search us, O God, and know our hearts today. Cleanse us from every sin and set us free. That's his prayer. Because he sees the world is a wicked place. But God's plan through Jesus Christ is to save us all from this wicked world. Won't you say amen? What a God we serve. God's plan. Not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. God's plan is to save us from this wicked world. And so, in the time when the world was wicked, and God looked at it and realized we can't allow the world to continue like this, he had a plan. He had a plan. And his plan was not just to destroy the world, but to save those who found grace in his eyes. Won't you say amen? And so God instructed Noah to build an ark as a means of salvation against the coming flood. And beloved, I can tell you, Noah was a sane man in a crazy world. You may want to write it down. Genesis chapter 6 and verse 12 to 14. You may want to make note of that and read that later on when you go home. But Noah, because God saw that Noah had a desire to be faithful, God instructed Noah to build an ark for the saving of the world. And I can just imagine when God told Noah, build an ark. Noah says, Lord, what's an ark? What's an ark? And God says, an ark is like a big boat. It's like a cruise ship. But build an ark. And just last year, I had a chance to go over into Kentucky where they have this replica. They say it's a life-size model of the ark. And we had an opportunity to go inside and see the design that was there. And Noah built something like that. And Noah built that in those days when there were no Home Depots. He built it in a time when there were no Lowe's. He built it in a time when they had no skill saws. So I believe it must have taken Noah a while to build this ark. And while Noah was building the ark, Noah was able to say to the people, when this ark is finished, it will become the place where if you want to be saved from the flood that is coming, you have to enter the ark. But the people listened. And in fact, I believe Noah needed help. So not only did they listen to his preaching, but some of them were helping him to hammer nails into the ark. They were carrying wood. They were cutting lumber. They were sealing holes in the ark so that it could stay on water. But they laughed at Noah because not only had they never seen a building like this before, but they didn't even know what he was going to do with it. For Noah was building the ark not next to Lake Galveston. Noah was building the ark way inland. What are you going to do with this? Noah says there's going to be a flood. God is going to send so much water that this whole place will be covered. And unless you enter this ark, you can't be saved. And did they laugh? Did they laugh? But I can tell you, beloved, Noah was not controlled by what people were saying. For he was listening to God. He was not listening to the people who were mocking God. For there were people who were laughing at Noah. There were people who says, there's never been anything like this before. We don't believe you. The Bible says in 2 Peter chapter 3, in verse 3, says, knowing this, first, that in the last days, scoffers will come. You write it down, read it. God knows that in the times in which we live, people are skeptical. People are agnostics. People are against God. People want to hear nothing about God. People are only satisfied with taking care of themselves and their own needs. They have no time for God. But Noah says, God says, there's coming a flood. And the more Noah preaches, the more people laughed. The more they mocked. The more they wouldn't listen. They laughed him to scorn. And can you imagine, day after day after day, as Noah built this ark and no rain fell, people were still laughing. I can just imagine the ark must have become like the circus of his days. You know, people would get up in the morning. They would have some breakfast. They would brush their teeth. They would put on their clothes. Somebody would say, where are you going today? They would say, we are going down to the circus of the ark. And they went down there. It was a big thing. They were laughing at Noah as he built the ark. They would laugh at his family as he built the ark. They would say, Noah, when is this rain that you're talking about going to come? They found it funny. They brought their cameras. They brought their cell phones. They took pictures beside the ark. They posed beside the ark. They pretended they were swimming beside the ark. Noah, look at us, they shouted. And every day they found it funny. The Bible seems to indicate in those days people didn't live as short as we live today. In those days people lived for hundreds of years. And the Bible seems to suggest that Noah might have been working on this ark for over 100 years. Can you imagine every day coming out there for that long, preaching, calling to people, enter the ark? And the more he preached, the more they laughed. But one day, beloved, the last nail went in the ark. One day, the last coat of paint went on the ark. One day, the last door was hung. The last window was placed in. One day, the last order of lumber was ordered. One day, the last thing needed for the ark was done. And when the ark was finished, the Bible says that there was still no rain. For 7 days, there was no rain. For 7 days, the people laughed at him. We told you so, Noah. We told you so. And then, at the end of the 7 days, as they stood there, laughing at Noah again as he invited them to enter the ark, they heard a little rustling behind them. They looked behind them towards the forest. And they saw animals lined up, two by two, orderly, not being led by anybody. Can you imagine wild animals on their own volition, lined up, walking towards the ark, orderly, no fighting? Can you imagine the deer and the lion? Normally a lion would eat a deer. But there they were, Mr. and Mrs. Lion, Mr. and Mrs. Deer, orderly, marching into the ark. You know, animals know danger when they see it. I'm told in the tsunami that occurred in Asia a few years ago that the animals, they realized that something dangerous was happening and they went, fled to higher grounds. If people are even as smart as animals, we would follow them. And so the animals went into ark. And the people who watched it found more reasons to laugh. They said, Noah, the ark is not going to get very stink. Can you imagine all that cow crap that you have to clean? Can you imagine all that elephant dung that you have to get rid of? What a stink place that ark is going to be. Still, people were rebellious. And I want to tell you, beloved, no sign, no miracle could move their rebellious hearts. And so they mocked Noah. No sign can move the heart of an unconverted man or woman. When you are converted and surrendered to the Holy Spirit, I am here to tell you, you will experience miracles and signs of God's favor all over you. You will walk away from a job because you want to serve God, and God will give you a better job. You will turn your back on a relationship because it's preventing you from accepting the Bible, the Word of God, and God will give you a better relationship. When you trust God, He puts His favor all over you. A better job. More money in your pocket. Food on your table. Just when you need it, God will provide it. You can testify like the man who says, I have seen God do so much with so little that I'm now convinced that God can do anything with nothing. We can trust Him. But beloved, while they mocked, while they laughed, one day the skies got dark. One day the thunders began to peal. One day, heavy with storm clouds, it became. And still nobody moved. Nobody. Even with all the signs. Nobody moved. Noah came to the ark door one last time. And he pleaded, friends. He called them by name. He looked at his neighbors. He looked at those who helped him. Perhaps that little boy who was the one that would bring water while they were building the ark. Son, won't you come? Maybe the little boy wanted to go, but his dad pulled him back and said, boy, don't embarrass me here. Don't embarrass me here. You're not going. Grabbed him back. And then, beloved, according to Genesis, as Noah made a final pleading, God says, Noah, it is time. It is time. And the Bible says, the Lord shut the door of the ark. And they that went in male and female, of all flesh, as God had commanded. And the Lord shut him in. It is not man who closed the door. It is God who closed the door. It is not man that we are here to please. It is God that we are here to please. It is not man that we must worry about. It is God that we must think about. It is not the newspapers that we must read. It is all Bibles that we must read. It is the Word of God. And God shut the door to keep him safe. Shut the door so it wouldn't open by accident in the height of the storm and the flood. Shut Noah in from the enemy. For what God closes, no man can open. And what God opens, no man can close. He shut Noah in, for it was time to separate the sheep from the goat. He shut Noah in after 120 years of preaching, after 120 years of pleading, after 120 years of calling, 120 years of testimony, 120 years of invitations to the truth to serve Jesus, 120 years of reaching out to family and friends and loved ones and neighbors. It was time to close the door. Finally, it was time to pay every man his just reward. Finally, it was time for man's probation to be closed. Finally, it was time to save those who love God. And then, beloved, so the mighty doors swung shut as God himself closed them, carefully making sure that all those who should be inside are on the inside. And all those who should be on the outside are on the outside. For nobody who should be saved will be lost. And nobody who should be lost will be saved. But God loves to save everybody. There was enough space on the ark for all those who wanted to be saved. God's heart of love yearns for all of us as he reaches out to save us, as he calls us to accept him. God's desire is that everyone would be saved. And beloved, we're living in a serious time. Today, like in Noah's time, it's a serious time. For when the rains came, because they were so stubborn, and they pleaded. Just pause with me a moment. Just imagine, the door is now closed. God had shut it. The animals are inside. Everything is quiet. The skies are black. Then there's a peal of thunder. They'd never heard thunder before. What's that? There's a flash of lightning. What's that? Just imagine the first raindrop. I wonder who it fell on. That first raindrop. Perhaps somebody was standing there thinking, when he heard the thunder, maybe I should have gone in. Maybe and imagine I was inside there helping Noah to fix the ark. I know I'm outside. And then he felt something. It's the first raindrop. And then other people begin to. Now it's raining. And the Bible says the skies were ominous and black. Lightning zigzag. The rumble of the thunder sounded loud. People became apprehensive. Suddenly they are thinking, maybe we should have gone in. Maybe. And the Bible describes that not only was rain coming down, but water was coming up. That the fountains of the deep, the aquifers underneath, were broken up, and water was gushing up, and water was pouring down. And suddenly people realized, we should be in the ark. What a mad dash there was towards the ark. What a mad dash towards the door. Noah, open up, let us in. Noah, our friend Noah, open us. Noah, it's me. And they call the name. Noah, won't you let us in? It's your friend. It's your neighbor. It's your cousin. It's your uncle. Open up, Noah. Let us in. But God had shut the door. Noah perhaps tried, but he couldn't open the door. For it was God who had shut the door. As they pounded, Noah's heart must have broke as he heard the desperate voices of his friends and neighbors. Try as he might, he couldn't open the door. It was too late. Outside, the water was rising. People ran to higher grounds. They climbed tall trees. They clung to the ark, but all in vain. It was too late now. As the water rose up to their waist, then up to their breast, then up to their neck, then it was right under their nose. Desperately, they tried to stay afloat. But it was too late now, for nothing could save them. All died, and only those in the ark were saved. All died because they had chosen to reject God. The ark was God's first means of saving mankind. First means. But they rejected it in defiance. Human plans were placed before God's plan. And when it was too late, there was no place for them to go. The Bible tells us, beloved, the Bible says, and you can read the text, you can write it down. What does the text say? Just as it was when? In the days of Noah, so will it be in the days of the Son of Man. People today are doing what? Eating, drinking, going to happy hours, marrying, giving into marriage, building, saving, investing, gambling, doing all kinds of things. Right up to the time when Noah went in the ark, then the floods came and destroyed them all. People today are doing the same thing as they did in the times of Noah. The Bible says that in the times of Noah, God says the earth was desperately wicked. Today, the earth is desperately wicked. And the same thing that God did then is the same thing he's going to do today. But he's given us, like Noah, an opportunity to choose his plan over man's plan. And so he says, beloved, we live in some serious times. This know also that in the last days, what will come? Perilous times. Men shall be what? Lovers of their own self. People just love themselves. You know, we spend so much time looking in the mirror at ourselves. You know, boasters, covetous, proud, blasphemers. You know what blasphemers are? Blasphemers are people who believe that, you know what, I know more than God. I don't need God. Disobedient to parents. Unthankful. Unholy. The Bible says, without natural what? Affection. I was watching. You know, one of the new things that is happening in this wicked world is what they call AI. You know what AI is? It's called artificial intelligence. That they are making robots now that could do math faster than you and I. In fact, your computer, your cell phone can do math faster. In fact, children don't know how to add anymore. In fact, they don't even know how to write a text. Handwriting is going out of style. But I saw on television, they had made this robot that looked like a human. And this lady had her hand around this robot and she said, "This is my friend." That she no longer had a natural affection for a humankind. She had an affection for a robot. That's the world in which we live. Natural affection is gone. Truth breakers, false accusers, incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good, traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasure more than whom? More than lovers of God. Having a form of godliness. That is the world in which we live. But as he did in the times of Noah, God is again preparing to put an end to it all. But he desires today, first of all, to save those who love him. To save those who do what? Love him. And so the Bible says, God is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness. But he's what? Long-suffering to all of us, not willing that any should perish, but that what should happen? But that all should do what? Come to repentance. God is calling all of us to enter the ark, to demonstrate repentance so that we can be saved when he comes. Our only hope for salvation is through Jesus Christ. Our only hope for salvation is through Jesus Christ. Let me say that again. Our only hope for salvation in this world is through Jesus Christ. He is the ark of safety. He is the way, the truth, and the life. The only way to be saved, the only future for man, is by following God's plan in Jesus Christ. And so, beloved, Christ is the only way. The text says, "For God so what? Loved the world." I don't want you to think that God just wants to kill us all. You know, God wanted to save the whole world, but he can't force anybody. And so, so the text reminds us. It says, "For God so loved this world that he did what? Gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him." Do you believe in him? Amen. Do you believe in him? Amen. "That whosoever believes in him should not perish like the people who didn't enter the ark. But if we accept him, we would have everlasting life." Won't you say amen? Amen. I want to close by pointing out a little thing here. Just remind you of the days in which we live. The guy in the picture there is Elon Musk. He is a South African by birth, but he is now a United States citizen. He lives in California. He is the guy who invented the car, Tesla. You ever heard of Tesla, the car? Yes, that's the guy. He is the guy who owns SpaceX. And I know we're living in Houston, NASA's country. And the idea is that the plan is that by the 2020s, that man should begin to colonize Mars. I'm talking about going to the planet Mars. Just like when the first pilgrims came to the United States, that we would establish outposts on Mars, where we would live on Mars, because we are making such a mess of this world. That the idea is that when this world self-destruct, either we blow ourselves up with nuclear or perhaps global warming and we can't live on this earth anymore, we would go to Mars. That's the idea. And so right now they're training astronauts for one-way trip. And those first people who go to Mars, it won't be like when they went to the moon. There's no Buzz Aldrin coming back. It will be a one-way trip. And either you may die by space radiation, or you may die because your brain may just boil on this trip. Our hope, however, I want you to hear me now. Our hope for the future is not Mars, it is heaven. I am not preparing to go to Mars. I am preparing to enter the ark of safety, to accept the love of Jesus Christ, so that when he comes, he can invite me to share his kingdom with him. Because as somebody says, we have made a mess of earth, and if we go to Mars, we'll make a mess in Mars as well. But when we get to heaven, where Jesus is our King and our Lord, what a glorious day that will be. And so, beloved, God is getting ready to take us home with him. He says, I what? I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be what? Oh, that's God's promise to us. He will come again. And when he comes, he'll take us home with him. Anybody want to go to Mars? Raise your hand. Anybody want to go to heaven? Raise your hand. Praise the Lord. That's where we all want to go, to be in heaven with Jesus. And so he says, and behold, I do what? That's Jesus' promise. He says, I come quickly, and my reward is with me to give every man according as his work shall be. He says, blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have what? Right to the tree of life, and may enter in through the gates into the city. He says, outside are dogs and sorcerers and sexually immoral people and murderers and idolaters and whoever loves and practices a lie, like those outside the ark, these are those who are outside. But he then says, with a beautiful invitation, and the Spirit and the bride says what? Come. That's God's invitation to say we should do what? Come, and let him who hears say what? Come, and let him who is athirst do what? Come, and whosoever desires, let him do what? Take the water of life freely. For Jesus Christ is the water of life. Won't you say amen? Amen. This is a beautiful invitation. The only way to be saved and the only future for you is by following God's plan. I'm going to give you some time now at your tables, as I promised you. It will be a brief 3 or so minutes. And here's what I want you to discuss at your table. Just discuss this with those at your table. What lessons can we learn from this Bible truth about the people's response to Noah's invitation to save themselves by entering the ark? Just take a few minutes. Talk with the person at your table. What kind of lessons can we learn from that? How should we respond to this lesson that we have just heard? There's a text there as well. Luke 17, 26, 27. Read a text. Luke 17, 26 and 27. Just take a moment to read a text at your table. And I'll give you a brief 3 minutes. At your table. And if you're not at a table and you want to join somebody at the table, do that. Yeah, just see what the text says. All right, we'll give you another minute to conclude the discussion. Give everybody a chance to share. Thank our table hosts for leading out in the discussions. Here's what you will do for me now, so we can get some feedback from you as you've considered that question. I'm going to invite everybody to take your cell phones out, all right? Have your cell phones? Let me see those cell phones. All right, we got some cell phones here this evening. Take your cell phones out, everybody. I wish we could give you more time, but I want to respect your time, and we're a little bit behind right now. Just take your cell phones out quickly and do exactly what you see on the screen. 37607. That's whom you're going to send the text to. That's the number. All right? So you send a new text and type in 37607. And then the message that you will send is DRMCLEAN. Just put that in. Don't worry about whether it's caps or anything. Just send that. Right? Are you with me? Because I'm going to move the screen shortly. All right, so that's a number. 376. Anybody need some more time to do that? 37607. That's who you send the text to. And then you're going to send it to, you're going to put the message, DRMCLEAN. If you've successfully logged in, you should get a response. All right? Anybody got a response since then? Yes, a few people have. Good. All right, and here is Here is what you're going to do. You are standing by the ark when Noah makes his final appeal. You want to enter. That's the question. But a friend or family hesitated. What would you do to encourage him or her to come with you? Send your response now. Text your response to that same number right now. Just tell me, what would you do to encourage your friend who is hesitating? They don't want to enter the ark. And don't text anything I didn't ask you, please. Just text what I ask you, all right? Okay, that's the question on the board. All right. Yes, see, the answers are coming in. All right, come on, send those messages in quickly. And grab him by the neck and what? And drag them in. I wish God would do that for us sometimes, but you know, God respects our freedom of choice. Plead and lead by example. Somebody said, pray for them. Pull them in. Hallelujah, indeed. Plead with them to join me. I even says, yes, remind them what happened to those who hesitated in Noah's days. Pull them in. All right, we're getting some responses. Don't send an epistle, just send a brief statement. We're going to close now. All right? Tell them they have nothing to lose, but they may lose it all if they don't follow. Isn't God good? And God wants our lives to be an example to others, that we would encourage them to walk with him, to come with him, and to be a part of his family. Now, here's how we close tonight. Here's how we close tonight. Thank you for your responses. Thank you very much for your responses. You have shared your responses so that all of us have been encouraged by the response, that we can care for each other, that we can love each other, and that by God's grace, we want each other to be in the ark of safety. Won't you say amen? Amen. Here's your response for tonight. Get your response cards from your hosts right now. Let's take your response cards quickly. And that's what your response card should look like. You're going to quickly fill out your response cards. Your pencils on the table. If the message was clear and it was a blessing to you, you can tick the first box. If you have some questions, you can tick the second box. Here is my answers. Here is my response to tonight's appeal. Maybe I didn't give you an option that you want to tick, but you have an option that you'd like to choose. You could write it in the line there for the third box. Here's my response, and then you write in what your response is. Maybe something I didn't think of, so you could fill that out. If you would appreciate for more clarity on the message that you've heard, a personal visit from myself, one of the pastors, one of the associates, one of the table hosts, then we would ask you to fill the last box. And so we also invite you, and we would like to encourage everybody to participate. We want this to be a community of learners that we're working together. Everybody, a part of the community. No spectators. So please, I encourage everyone to be a part of this experience. Just fill in the information. Hand the card to your ushers. Notice under the second option, it says, please see my question on the back of this card. So if you have a question, something that wasn't clear, something that you didn't understand, please write it on the back of the card, and we will do our very best, maybe tomorrow night or by Tuesday night, to be responding to the questions that you've raised. All right. So we invite you to do that as well. Right? So that's your, and as soon as you have finished, you can hand in your response card to the person at your table. So we're going to ask the table host just to collect the cards as soon as the individuals are through. As soon as they're through, just collect the card. And while you're doing that, our next presentation will be tomorrow evening. It's entitled Secrets and Signs of the Rapture. Secrets and Signs of the Rapture. Tomorrow evening, 7:30, I invite you to be back, to be here with your loved ones. Bring somebody. As we close, we have refreshments through this door. There's a little box of refreshments which is there for you. And we invite you to stop by so you can get some refreshments. Have you been blessed this evening? Amen. Praise the Lord. I want to invite you now to bow your heads. If you want to enter God's ark of safety, I invite you to bow your heads with me as we pray together. Heads are bowed. Heads are bowed as we pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you that when this world will finally come to an end, because of your divine intervention, because of its wickedness, may we be saved with Jesus in your eternal kingdom. Take us home safely. Give us a good night. Bring us back tomorrow evening. Help us to tell somebody. Tomorrow night we can be blessed as we consider the secrets and the signs of the rapture. In Jesus' name we pray. And everyone say amen. Amen and amen. God bless you. God bless you.